Why don't we talk about what is science? Before we outline what is scientific realism, in order for you to counter that with scientific anti-realism.
Well, but that's exactly the question that divides the realists and anti-realists. And when I was studying, you know, as a graduate student, one of my teachers was Wilfred Sellers, main scientific realist of the day. And my impression was that there was a total focus on the products of science, the theories that the scientists come up with. But science is an activity, it's an enterprise. And what defines a human enterprise is the aim, the goal, the telos, as they say. So I thought that the way the question should be asked was, what is the aim of the scientific enterprise? And the only way to answer it would be to look at what the scientists actually do when they are evaluating each other. And it always comes down to empirical tests. If a theory has no empirical implications, very soon they regard it as mere metaphysics. If it does have empirical implications, they ask for what are the experiments that will tell us which way to go. So I proposed that the aim of science, the way to define science is by its aim. And I propose that the aim is to give us empirically adequate theories that, you know, work on the empirical level. And my teacher, Wilfred Sellers, had totally different answers. His answer was that it aims to give us literally true theories about what there is in detail to explain. For him, the aim of the enterprise of knowledge was to be in a position where you can explain what you have. And that's where the discussion began for me.
Are most scientists scientific realists, or they think of themselves as scientific realists?
Well, you know, by my definition of a scientific realist is someone who believes that the aim is to produce literally true theories about what there is, with nothing added, nothing lost. Okay, I think that most people, when they ask if they are scientific realists, they think what you mean is, do you believe that the current scientific theories are true? Right. And some scientific realist philosophers make that part of their position, the belief that our current best theories are true, maybe with some approximation, right? Now, you don't have to be a philosopher to believe that theories are true, right? I mean, that's, you know, you believe or you don't believe, that's fine, you know. The question is, you know, what is the criterion of success for these theories? Right? If they fail empirically, they fail. And I say, if they succeed empirically, they succeed. That's what science is.
Why are you considered to be a scientific anti-realist?
Oh, because succeeding on the empirical level does not imply truth. A theory will introduce many extra things that are not directly measurable, right? Many quantities in a theory in physics specifically can only be measured via some theoretical equations in your calculations. So you have direct measurements, but then a theoretical quantity is one that can only be measured by a theory-guided measurement, right? And success on the empirical level is success with respect to the direct measurements. So that logically leaves open the possibility that, in fact, the theory is not true about what else there is. And that's the anti-realist position.
It sounds to me like that's not anti-realist. At least in my head, when I think of anti-realist, it's as if you're saying that they're definitely not describing reality.
Oh, no. No.
But it sounds to me more like you're saying you're agnostic as to what's being described.
Yes, yes.
Well, I'll give you an example. Like, a theist is someone who would believe in God. An atheist is someone I would consider to be almost an anti-theist. I mean, but that obviously has a different connotation.
Yeah.
But an agnostic would be someone who's undecided. So it sounds to me more like you're you're agnostic. And I don't know where this word anti, maybe it's historical, or maybe I have a misconception of the prefix.
No, you could be a scientific gnostic or a scientific agnostic, right? You could, without being a philosopher, right? Without worrying about what science is, just you're a gnostic or an agnostic about it, right? As I say, I believe or I'm not sure, whatever. It seems to me that the philosophical issues are separate from that. They're separate from belief. So I would say that if you accept the scientific theory, then you believe that it is empirically adequate, that it will be empirically successful if you accept it. Now, you could add the belief that it is true. That's up to you. But I would say it's supererogatory.
Now, Hilary Lawson is an English philosopher who's known for being either an anti-realist or a non-realist. And I'm unsure what the distinction is between those two, but it's either way, it's more broad than being a scientific anti or a scientific non-realist.
Yes, it is. Yeah.
Can you briefly outline the general view of non-realism or anti-realism to distinguish it from your scientific non-realism or anti-realism?
Well, I would say to begin, I'm a common sense realist. Okay. I mean, I have, unlike some philosophers, I have no difficulty with referring to rocks and trees and saying there is no philosophical problem about my reference to you know, Curt, right? Or my computer, or the rocks that I climb, or the trees that I walk among, right? I'm a common sense realist. Now, there's a more sophisticated question that they can ask. They say, well, what do you think about truth and falsity? Are statements sometimes neither true nor false? I would say, yeah, I think there's lots of examples where they're neither true nor false. But in the case of the language of a scientific theory, I say they are true or false. That's it. They're true or false. No, it has nothing to do with what we know necessarily, right? So there's the kind of realist who doubts that. And this anti-realist, I mean, the kind of anti-realist who doubts that, right? And there's the kind of anti-realist who just says, no, it's false, right? And I think that they should just call them skeptics. That is not, to me, whether theories are true or false is not a philosophical question.
Interesting. Whether theories are true or false is not a philosophical question.
Right. It's a matter of fact, and nature will decide for us.
Right. I believe you once said the argument for scientific realism, one of the largest ones, is the no miracles argument.
Yes.
And for people who don't know what the no miracles argument is, I can place a link on screen to it. It basically says that how else can you explain the level of predictive success of science unless it was approximately true?
That's interesting. That's interesting. Shall I say something about that?
Yes, please.
But yeah, so the no miracle argument is, look, science is so successful that if the scientific theories must be true, otherwise it would be too much of a coincidence for them all to give us true predictions, right? Now, I would say, okay, well, there's a fact to the success of science, and you're asking for an explanation of it. Now, if you look to scientists, when they explain the success of a theory, what do? When they want to explain the success of Newtonian theory, they say, oh, well, you know, it gives good approximations to the answers that we now get from relativity, right? And if they want to say some of the predictions of Galileo were correct, they say, well, a good approximation to Newton's laws in certain respects, right? So always what they do is they explain the success of a previous theory in terms of the current theory, right? Okay, so now if that's the right pattern of scientific explanation, what would be an explanation of science as a whole? Impossible, right? I mean, the only thing that's left is an unscientific explanation. Because you can't, if you always explain the success of a science by appeal to a later or better science, then you cannot do that for current science as a whole. So the new medical arguments really ask for an unscientific explanation.
Because they're making an appeal to some future undetermined science, some idealized final science?
Maybe that's what they're doing, yeah.
Are you referencing Hempel's dilemma or no?
Putnam and Boyd, I mean, Hempel started that kind of discussion, but Putnam and Boyd gave the numerical argument. Yeah.
Ah.
Mm-hmm. And so, you know, they say in effect, look, can you explain the success of science? They say, we can explain it by saying that theories are true. Right? And I'm saying, well, look, you're not following the pattern of a scientific explanation here. When scientists give explanations of the success of theories, they do something quite different. They always appeal to the later or better theory. And you cannot do that for science as a whole.
I remember you said that a mouse doesn't have to survive to be true. It doesn't have to have a true model of the cat. It just has to survive. And mm-hmm. so you were thinking of theories, or at least saying that one possible explanation for the truth of theories is that we generate a variety of theories. Mm. Many, if not most of them, die. Yeah. And the ones that are left have survived, but that survival isn't the same as being truthful.
Yeah. I think that's how it works in science. When a theory fails an empirical test, then either it's modified or discarded. That's natural selection, right? And so not surprising that the theories that we accept are successful theories, because the unsuccessful ones, we discard it or we modify them so as to make different theories.
So then what would be the best way to, or best method to uncover or investigate quote-unquote reality, if not the scientific one?
I think that theories about what goes beyond the phenomena, beyond the appearances, they are just representations, and there will always be different possible representations. When you have two of them, quite often you can decide that one of them is better than the other by some test, but there would always be other possible representations of it. I do not think there is a way to get behind the phenomena. No. I mean, not more than what we do. No.
Can you contrast common sense realism with naive realism?
Yeah, a naive realist would also say, you know, numbers exist and colors exist and so on. In some ways, of course, I'm saying, yeah, of course. I mean, in some ordinary way of speaking, you know, there are prime numbers, right? Some things are red and some things are blue. But the naive realist will reify everything. Gilbert Ryle called it the quote Fido principle, that, you know, if you have a word, then it has to refer to something. I think that's naive realism. I resist that very much. I resist reification very much, yeah.
Hi, everyone. Hope you're enjoying today's episode. If you're hungry for deeper dives into physics, AI, consciousness, philosophy, along with my personal reflections, you'll find it all on my Substack. Subscribers get first access to new episodes, new posts as well, behind-the-scenes insights, and the chance to be a part of a thriving community of like-minded pilgrimers. By joining, you'll directly be supporting my work and helping keep these conversations at the cutting edge. So click the link on screen here, hit subscribe, and let's keep pushing the boundaries of knowledge together. Thank you and enjoy the show. Just so you know, if you're listening, it's curtjaimungal.org, curtjaimungal.org.